We can get started. Mr. Manager, are you not ready? Are you ready?
Yes, we are. Yes.
Okay. And so you want to go through the agenda overview?
Well, we have Brian queued up.
Oh, okay.
Brian. I heard the noise again last time.
Good evening, Council. First, let me start off with an update on the city's two legislative requests. I'm happy to report that the city's request for the Commonwealth to study sea level rise is in great shape and that we will more than likely be passed by the General Assembly. It's never a done deal until the governor signs, but we are in real good shape for passage. SJ 76, which is the Senate version, and HJ 50 are now identical in language and have been modestly changed since their introduction. With the friendly amendments that have now been added since session, each bill now requests the Virginia Institute of Marine Science to work collaboratively with ODU, UVA, and other higher education institutions and regulatory agencies to study strategies for adaptation to prevent recurrent flooding in Tidewater and Eastern Shore Virginia localities. The Senate included in the Finance Committee's budget $50,000 to fund the requested study. However, the House did not. Additionally, a funding clause was attached to SJ 76 in the Senate, which effectively says our bill does not pass the General Assembly unless it is a $50,000 is appropriated by the General Assembly to complete the estimated $147,000 study. SJ 76 has passed the House, and the Senate has accepted the House's amendments. SJ 76 is in queue for passage. The House version, HJ 50, will be considered by the Senate during tomorrow's session. Since a budget amendment was not passed in the House and the Senate financial clause was attached to SJ 76, our bills will now be going to conference committee. Staff and Kemper Consulting remain cautiously optimistic our bills and their amendments will be successfully passed, and all efforts are being accomplished to get our study commissioned and funded by the Commonwealth as requested by Council. On to Norfolk's other legislative request. As you know, at crossover, the city attorney flagged two bills, HB 1220 and SB 546, which would allow Roanoke County to expand their industrial development authority to 10 members. Considering Council's expressed desire to create a more robust and representative economic development authority, the city requested to be added to both bills granting similar authority for our economic development authority. If passed, the Norfolk City Council would have the authority to expand the EDA from 7 members to 11 members. Thanks to an official request letter from the mayor on behalf of the City Council to both patrons, Norfolk was added to both bills. The Senate recently passed HB 1120, and the House has agreed to the Senate's amendments. SB 546 has passed the House, and we think it's marked to pass as well. On to state deliberations. As you know, Council, from the press's reporting, we're experiencing some interesting times up here at the state capitol. The House of Delegates passed their budget, HB 3079-21, last Thursday, February 23rd. Of note is that of Norfolk's 6 delegates, 4 voted in favor of HB 30, and they were delegates Kenny Alexander, Algie Howe, Johnny Joanna, and Chris Dolly. 2 of our delegates voted in opposition, and they were delegates James and delegate Lewis. The Senate, however, failed to pass the budget amendments. Although 20 Republican senators voted for the Senate Finance Committee's recommendations contained in SB 30, 17 Democrats opposed the measure. 3 other Democrats did not vote, including Norfolk's own Senator Y.B. Miller and Portsmouth's Louise Lucas. This means that SB 30 died on the Senate floor effectively. So today, the Senate Finance Committee voted to conform the House budget bills, HB 29 and 30, with the package of amendments the committee approved on February 19th. This is the same package of amendments that failed to pass the Senate last Thursday. The 2 Senate budget bills, SB 29 and 30, then died on a partisan vote 20-20 on the Senate floor again today. It's unclear at this time if the Senate will approve or reject the budget bills. If the Senate kills the legislation, then there will be no budget bills for the General Assembly to consider. Senate Democrats have signaled that they are in no particular hurry to pass a budget. This leaves 2 likely scenarios, Council. Under the first scenario, the House budget is referred to the Senate Finance Committee again. The committee can substitute its own recommendations in lieu of the House budget amendments. HB 30 would be reported to the Senate floor, and another vote would take place. If the Senate Republicans and Democrats can patch up the differences, the budget will pass and the House and Senate Budget Conference will get underway. However, the second scenario is not a good one. It assumes that HB 30 will also die on the Senate floor, leaving the state without a new budget for the remainder of FY12 and without any budget for the new biennium that begins July 1st. If this happens, Governor McDonald can ask the General Assembly to extend the session to allow more time for the two parties to and the Senate to reconcile their differences. Or the governor can call a special session of the General Assembly to deal with the crisis. From a legal standpoint, the General Assembly does have until July 1st to enact a budget for the 2012-2014 biennium. However, each chamber is required to act on their budget bills by midnight tomorrow. Notwithstanding the current stalemate, the number of local government concerns are addressed in some form by the two money committees presently. Both amendment packages provide for more fund support for public education than the budget bill introduced by Governor McDonald. $165 million in the Senate and $136 million in the House was allocated in addition. Both packages demonstrate a commitment to reduce a recent across-the-board cuts to local governments known as local aid to the Commonwealth. The House amendments would have reduced the $95 million biennial cut to $50 million, while the Senate amendments could reduce the figure even lower to $45 million. Both packages also provide additional funding for preserving the state's safety net for health care and boosting state health compensation. On to the House and Senate transportation bills. Obviously, they are at odds. After passing their own versions of the governor's transportation bill, the House and the Senate are miles apart in addressing how Virginia should pay for building and maintaining roads. While different in certain aspects from the introduced bill, HB 1248 agrees with the governor's proposal to heavily rely upon state general fund dollars at the expense of other general fund priorities such as education and public safety. But by contrast, SB 639 Wagner rejects the increase in the general fund appropriations to transportation and instead proposes indexing of the gasoline tax for inflation. While both proposals would provide hundreds of millions of dollars more in annual dedicated money for transportation, both fall well short the documented annual need of more than $1 billion in the Commonwealth. Here's a quick breakdown of the comparison of the House and the Senate budgets transportation bills versus the governor's introduced. As you'll recall, Council, in the governor's introduced transportation omnibus, it increases the transportation share of year-end surpluses from two-thirds to three-fourths. The current 0.50% of state sales tax now dedicated for transportation would be increased to 0.75% over an eight-year period. The first 1% in state revenue growth, over 5% each year, would also be dedicated to transportation as opposed to general fund. This also authorizes the CTB to implement a version of a tax increment financing. The only new source of revenue comes from authorizing the Commonwealth Transportation Board to sell naming rights of highways, bridges, interchanges, and other transportation facilities. Any fees generated would go into a statewide highway maintenance fund. When you look at the House, it essentially mirrors what the governor has originally proposed, but it eliminates the tax increment financing proposal and retains all the other measures with one significant modification. The first 1% in state revenue growth over 8%. Would be what the trigger would be, as opposed to the governor's proposed 5%. In the Senate version, it eliminates all general fund transfers and instead increases the current tax on the motor fuels of 17.5 cents per gallon annually by the percentage increase of the U.S. Department of Labor Producer Price Index. If enacted, the tax per gallon would increase to 17.7 cents per gallon on July 1, 2012. The Senate also proposes adding electrical vehicles to alternative fuel vehicles in order to collect an annual $50 registration fee. Lastly, the Senate proposes removing the five-year sunset clause under the authority, allowing Northern Virginia and Hampton Roads localities to levy by referendum a 1% income tax for transportation if they chose to do so. Specific staff commentary on these transportation omnibus bills, Council, is that with regard to transportation planning, the House accepted and the Senate rejected the governor's proposal to allow the CTB to withhold funds if a locality's comprehensive plan is inconsistent with the state's six-year transportation plan. Both chambers rejected the governor's proposal to create a statewide tolling authority to construct, maintain, and operate all tolls and transportation facilities. The Senate accepted and the House rejected the governor's proposal allowing localities to contribute general fund revenue to revenue tolls on certain state privately owned transportation facilities. Both chambers approved expanding VDOT's revenue sharing program to include maintenance. Currently, the state matches local money dollar for dollar on a capital improvements within the locality. of the two competing transportation omnibus bills, obviously most local governments, VML, VACO, Virginia First Cities, including Norfolk, are registered as supportive of SB 639. On to the last important legislative topic I'd like to discuss with you tonight, Council, it's eminent domain. While the constitutional amendment dealing with eminent domain has passed both the House and Senate, a handful of important bills to it are working their way through the committee process. The amendment to SJ3 provides that the General Assembly must define lost access and lost profits, which are new elements dealing with just compensation that will have to be paid when private property is taken. HB 1035 and SB 437 define the two terms. The identical bills limit the amount of lost access or lost profits a landowner may recover. They exclude payments for lost access occasioned by the lost in the common of the general community, including off-site circuitry or travel diversion of traffic arising from exercise of the police power. If this language is found to be constitutional, it will limit the expensive impact of the amendment on local governments. However, the Virginia Supreme Court ultimately rules that the statute may not eliminate an element of just compensation that the Constitution provides. Localities will face regular inverse condemnation claims when they temporarily close a street for public safety reasons, whether it's a water main break or if we have to close a road for street widening. The constitutional amendment also likely creates another problem by eliminating the ability of local governments to condemn land for utilities such as water and sewer for streets when the utility or the street will be used for an economic development purpose. The amendment states that public utility corporations may condemn for utilities in all cases, but it does not protect localities or water or sewer authorities extending water and sewer, and it does not address road extensions for economic development projects. These bills are likely to be passed in the General Assembly and to be signed by the governor. We will have to definitely adjust our operations once they are in full force. At this time, Council, I'd be happy to answer any questions you might have.
Thanks, Brian. That was very thorough. we're gonna have to get some bullets from you or something like this. Okay. Thank you. Thanks for what you're doing up there, Brian. Appreciate it.
Yes, sir. Well, sine die or session conclusion is scheduled to occur next Saturday, March 10th, and the reconvened session is scheduled to occur on April 18th.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, Mr. Manager.
Sure. Mayor and Council, before we turn over to a couple of the presentations, two key issues that Brian brought up, I'd like to talk to you about the impact here in Norfolk. In other words, K-12 education and also age localities reduction. In K-12 education, basically the House version provides another $1.3 million to Norfolk Public Schools. The version that came out of the Senate Finance Committee, again, the Senate doesn't have a bill, but the version that came out of the Senate Finance Committee would add another $3.5 million. That's in FY13. So you take that and you look at both years of the biennium and FY14, the House budget again provides $1.3 million both in 13 and 14. That's not additive, just $1.3 million more. The Senate Finance Committee, again, $3.5 million more in 13, $2.1 million more in 14. In age localities, that's been about a $2.8 million hole in our budget over the years when the state basically spread a cut throughout the different localities. Basically, what the House would do would be restore almost $1 million. So in other words, there's at least two positive movements for us at the local level. What it means to Norfolk would be what we're seeing from both the Senate Finance Committee and the House would provide additional funds for K-12 education, as well as we could get some relief from that across-the-board cut to localities. With that said, basically tonight we have a series of presentations, a quick overview or update on the Norfolk Consortium. Then we have OPSAIL 2012. That's something that I believe we talked a little bit about last week. We have Karen Sherberger here, who's going to give us a preview of what will be occurring here in June. We have an economic development opportunity with the Chick-fil-A restaurant. We have set aside some time to discuss people. I will tell you that Ron Williams will give you a quick overview, but this is something that we've talked about since September as it relates to what we would do for new businesses. We do want to look at it more comprehensively, and Ron will give you that, but at least we will give you an opportunity to gather, we'll provide some data to you related to what the impact would be to Norfolk. And then lastly, and I commit to you, we will get through all of this so that we have ample time for council interests and issues, and there's a couple things from the administration that I'd like to present at the end. But we do have one agenda item that deals with electronic copy signs, and again, something that we had discussed in the fall that we'll bring back to you today, and Frank will give you an update. With that said, we can go right into the consortium.
My first PowerPoint presentation, and I promise Mark it's going to be very short. I'm really excited to talk to you all about the consortium and the Norfolk Accelerator program that we're going to participate in after OpSale. It's really cool, and I think it's what makes Norfolk very special. And I'm going to get this clicker to work. Okay. First, I wanted to remind you of the Norfolk Consortium's vision. It is a group of arts and cultural organization is to really cement Norfolk as a vibrant, dynamic, and innovative city, which is home to the best cultural, entertainment, and visitor attractions in the country. We have 14 members of the consortium, the Virginia Arts Festival, the Fest Events, the Virginia Symphony, MacArthur Memorial, Visit Norfolk, seven venues, the NATO Festival, Botanical Garden, Chrysler Museum, Virginia Stage Company, National Maritime Center, the Zoo, and the Virginia Opera. Since its inception 8 months ago, it has been very busy. In our first grant cycle, which we updated you all in November, the consortium awarded five grants to these following organizations, totaling $556,000. The Virginia Arts Festival is going to use some of that money for the tattoo, but what's really cool, and I put it all at your spots, is the Chocolate Festival that is coming in March. We're going to have a delicious chocolate festival for 2 days at the Norfolk Scope. The OpSale money for the OpSale is going to be used for citywide transportation system connecting hotels to all the Norfolk attractions during the OpSale event, so that's very exciting. Chrysler Museum used some of the money for the glass studio to bring international glass artists to the glass studio. The Crispus Attucks Cultural Center is using it for the Black Film Festival that we will be hosting in April. And we also put together a holiday travel package around the holiday season. It was really a cool thing. It was all of our attractions, what we have going on in Norfolk. We connected all of our retail and travel partners together, and we marketed it outside of the area within driving distance, so families looking for something to do that didn't want to drive too far, they could come to Norfolk. We just finished the second round of a winter grants, and $202,000 is under consideration here. These are some of the applicants that applied, and some of the activities in those applications are the 2012 Eagle Festival, a new Rib Fest coming to Town Point Park, which is really cool, a collaboration between the Virginia Symphony and the Chrysler Museum, and this is neat, is going to be a free public concert called Sound and Fire on the banks of the Hague this summer. And Military Games, which is, and I hope I pronounced this right, a quadrathlon event for all branches of the military. And that's going to be exciting. The Hampton Roads Sports Commission included that in their application. So we want to also let you know that all the consortium decided to use Visit Norfolk as its one-stop shop for all of the special events. So I encourage you to visit their calendar on their website. They enhance their website. It is a one-stop shop for all families or individuals looking for events going on. Representatives from the consortium were trained on how to place their events on the calendar, so that calendar is always kept up to date for all the exciting things that are going on. The consortium developed a marketing plan, and they also met with three focus groups, the 20 to 30-somethings, multicultural, and diversity, and they really came away with some great food for thought. I sat in the 20 to 30-something group and listened to ideas about, you know, block parties and festivals and things like that where we could just enhance what Norfolk has to offer folks and be really just vibrant and cool. And then I'm really excited to tell you about, and I didn't make a slide for this, but coming after OpSale is what's called the Norfolk Accelerator Program. We were approached by Zach Miller, who is the project director for We Are Titans. It is a custom software company headquartered right here in Norfolk, about an idea. And it's what it is they're going to host an intensive mentorship, hardcore 2 to 3 month program for early stage startup companies. It's specifically for technology and innovative business models, and they need to be able to, in that 2 to 3 month period, walk away with some type of product or a prototype for a business model. All they wanted from us was some space and internet. So once OpSale is out, we're going to put the Norfolk Accelerator Group into our design center. You're going to be able to walk down the street, see these guys and ladies in there with their laptops working 24 hours and their fingers flying, churning out some sort of product that in 2 to 3 months they can say, we made that here in Norfolk, and we hope they'll stay, create their little business, and it'll just keep growing and growing and growing. And we're going to do signage and give them some PR love, and it's just going to be really cool. Do you have any questions?
Great, thanks. All right, that was pretty good for the first time.
Meeting Mayor Frame, members of council, City Manager Jones, I appreciate the opportunity to come back before you and brief you on this project, which is just a little under 4 months away, a little more than 4 months away, which I am very confident is going to prove to be one of the most spectacular events that we've seen here in Norfolk and beyond Norfolk and beyond the region. You'll see here shortly just how this event led by Norfolk has really grown and developed over the last year and a half. As quick background, Operation SAIL 2012 Virginia is co-produced, co-planned with the United States Navy, but also with support from the United States Coast Guard and all of the U.S. Sea Services. We are very fortunate, very honored to be one of six cities that have been selected in the year 2012 in the Gulf and East Coast. We share this international platform with New Orleans, with Baltimore, with Boston, New York, and New London. And the schedule is here. The ships will actually begin to arrive in April in New Orleans and then move up to New York in May over top of Memorial Day weekend, which is the traditional Fleet Week event. And then the fleet comes back south and is joined up with a number of ships that haven't visited the other cities here in Norfolk in June, which will lay over top of the traditional Harbor Fest weekend, follow right up to Boston, and then to New London. We have a number of firsts with this event, things that that we've never tried before, but we're 100% confident that these efforts are going to prove to be extremely successful. This is the first time that we've rolled out a 12-day calendar of events throughout the region, all under one umbrella, starting June 1st to the 12th. Every single day, there'll be events that will fall underneath this OpSale umbrella. We have 3.5 miles of connected Norfolk waterfront that will be activated June 6th through the 12th. We have over 20 participating cities throughout the Commonwealth, all of these efforts led by the City of Norfolk, which represent easily 78, and every day the list grows, different events and activities over the 12 days. To date, we have 15 nations confirmed with their visiting ships. Peru, the Navy of Peru contacted us on Friday and said we're coming. So we're getting to that point now where we're getting some late calls, but there's more room at the table, and we certainly welcome them, which is one of the great things about our Norfolk Harbor. And I'm going to show you something here in a second, which will really impress you. So in addition to the 15 nations that are coming, we fully anticipate that we'll have another 20-plus diplomatic delegations coming from D.C. representing the other countries through their naval attachés. So far, when you cast a net over all of the ships that are coming, and to date, we have upwards of 55 ships involved from all over the world. That's over 4,000 crew members, cadets and officers. That's a lot of house guests that we're going to have here from June 6th to the 12th. So far, we have 65 confirmed tour groups representing 11 states and 12 international film and travel writers confirmed to visit Virginia during OpSale, and currently in 22 countries on the Travel Channel, we're promoting travel to Norfolk. The impact is extremely impressive when you look at the data and the statistics that we used in 2000 and 2007, and based on what we know, we're very confident that over these 12 days throughout the region and beyond, we'll see upwards of 3 million visitors attending all of the different events, not just in Norfolk, but throughout the region and beyond. And we fully expect over the June 6th through 12 dates, 1.5 million in Norfolk, with 120 million projected visitor spending, 6 million which would come directly back to the Commonwealth, and 75 million to the local localities and the local taxes generated from our event marketing investments. The type of support that we're receiving for this event is mind-boggling. If you run right to the bottom line, this is a $90 million production. I'm sure there are a lot of productions in Hollywood that have pretty hefty budgets, but we are so fortunate to be able to bring something of this magnitude to our city and to our region. And the message that we try to bring home every day is, let's not wake up on June 13th and find out that we've left an opportunity untouched or undeveloped and money on the table. This event is so broad and so extensive that there's an opportunity for every business and every organization to get involved and benefit from this event. And the support has been huge from the state to the federal level and to our corporate community as well. The way that we're managing and developing this event falls into several major initiatives. There's a tourism and marketing and small business economic impact initiative. We've been working very closely with the Norfolk EDA staff, along with the Chamber of Commerce and the state's Economic Development Partnership Group, to make sure that this event becomes a huge platform for businesses large and small. And it's really, the plan and the models are working very well. We have a wonderful education program that was rolled out 2 years ago statewide, and the curriculum that's been developed K through 12 has been integrated into the school systems. We have a very extensive civic and community involvement program for volunteers and community organizations, a huge protocol and diplomatic program, again, working very closely with our economic development partners and the PR departments throughout the cities and the regions, a very well-developed and will be well-executed transportation plan. We learned a lot from holidays in the city, and we're working very closely with Light Rail and HRT to make sure that we maximize all of the transportation opportunities that we have, land, water, and even in the air, and a very extensive security plan that's being worked at all levels, the federal, state, regional, and all of the local localities are very much involved. So we get to who's coming. Right now, the nations that are coming are Bermuda, Brazil, Canada, Colombia, the Cook Islands, Denmark, Ecuador, Germany, Indonesia, Mexico, Norway, Peru, Spain, the United Kingdom, and of course the USA. When you take a look at all the ships that are coming, just the 35 ships, 35 of the 55 that are docked in Norfolk on the Norfolk waterfront, and we ran these numbers a little while ago, it measures 7,734 linear feet of ship. That equates to 21 football fields lined up end to end. That's a pretty impressive number. So I won't go through each of these, but this is to give you an idea of the types of ships that are coming, tall ships. And then for the first time, as I mentioned, lots of firsts with this event, we're involving the gray hulls, or the traditional Navy ships, from the United States as well as from many of the other countries, such as Peru. Peru doesn't have a tall ship, but they want to participate, so they're sending their gray hull.
Aren't those we stay at the naval base, I take it?
They're all staying downtown. All of these ships that are here, with the exception of the WASP, which is the official reviewing platform, they're all staying downtown.
Wow.
It will be one amazing sight when you take a look at how this is coming together. We have three parades of sail as opposed to one. The first will be on June 6th. This is the parade that brings all the gray hulls and the Navy ships in, following the same parade of sail route that we use on Friday. It's a 30-mile parade of sail route, leaving the Lynn Haven Anchorage and coming all the way into downtown. On Thursday night, the 7th, all the tall ships rendezvous off of Lynn Haven Anchorage, parade in on the 8th. And then on Tuesday the 12th, all the ships will parade in formation as they leave Norfolk to Baltimore. We're going to keep them all together for a great opportunity for all the communities up the bay, on both sides of the bay. All these smaller Middle Peninsula, Upper Peninsula, Northern Neck communities are coming out with their ships and boats and escorting the fleet up to Baltimore. So again, this is just another view of all the cities and the communities that will have ships. They're not just here in Norfolk, but Hampton, Chesapeake, Yorktown, Tangier Island, Cape Charles, and Nancock, and others. Now we start bringing it down closer to home. The thumbnails show where the ships will be docked. This is a 3.5 mile route, which will start in Harbor Park. Ships won't be at Harbor Park. We'll explain that in a second. But the continuous walk and the continuous experiences will start at Harbor Park and end at MHI. We're actually in West Ghent because we have so many ships and so many of these larger military ships that we've had to move into West Ghent. And Gary Brandt has donated his entire MHI campus for us to accommodate the ships. And we'll be incorporating the Elizabeth River Trail in as well. So this just takes you through some of the docking configurations, every available dock space.
Where's my boat?
Where's Parks? You're in the marina right there.
There it is.
But we'll have ships all around the marina into Otter Berth. We'll be bringing in temporary piers once again to lay along Town Point Park in front of Nauticus or behind Nauticus, all around Whiskey Basin. The Canadian ship, the Peruvian ship, and the Brazilian Greyhulls will all be in Freemason. The NOAA space is turning into an incredible education center. All of the universities throughout the region and beyond that have these educational ships are all converging on NOAA, and that's going to be a great site. We come over the bridge, and we're in the Front Street property. Wayne McCluskey, before he passed away, donated his entire space to us, and his family is honoring that commitment. We'll be at the Army Corps of Engineers. We're activating the Elizabeth River Trail that will connect visitors by boat, by bike, by foot, for strollers, over into the MHI space. Gary has also donated the use of all his parking lots over there as well. So it's a spectacular, incredible, spectacular waterfront. We will have 3 barges, possibly 4, with fireworks so we can span that whole waterfront. And as I said, this lays over top of Harborfest, the traditional events of Harborfest, but we're also taking the theme of 1812 and bringing that to life throughout Freemason Harbor, much like we did in 2007 with Sail Virginia, with a lot of the personalities and characters and celebrities from that time. And then over in the space around Waterside, we're focusing on ship life of 1812. We're very excited about the number of adoptive schools in Norfolk in 2000, I think we had 4. And in 2007, I think we had 5. So the turnout has been huge this year. We're really excited about that. Lori was talking about the freeway. I'm going to wrap this up real quickly. I mean, the consortium project. The way that we're using the funds from the consortium to support OPSAIL is we have extended an invitation to all the hotels in Norfolk to participate free of charge. And we're running buses, fleets of buses, to participating hotels. We have 15 right now in the Military Highway Corridor, Newtown Road, over on Old Dominion, Hampton Boulevard, all the way down to the Naval Base, and all the downtown hotels. And these buses will connect to our depot, which will be Harbor Park. All of our buses, all of our forms of transportation will converge there, and then they will be able to board 3 different routes that will take them to all the downtown attractions, as well as one of the routes will go out to Botanical Gardens and pick up all the hotels going in that direction, and another route will take them down through the downtown area down to the zoo, and then for the first time, since 9/11, the base is opening itself up for public tours. So we'll be taking bus tours onto the base to tour. I think right now there's 6 ships, including the Wasp, that the Navy has opened up. And this will be running from early in the morning to well after midnight, Friday and Saturday night, until the business closes on Sunday and again on Monday. Round trip transportation. The hotels love it. They've already started promoting it, and it's been very well received. So these are some of the events taking place in Norfolk, not just with what we've done, but we've included the Chrysler. The event with the symphony and the fireworks will take place the weekend before OPSAIL, and all throughout the city. We have other organizations that are affiliating. These are some of the ads that we're running nationwide. We're in the visitor guides, Virginia Living Magazine, Sea History Magazine. I can't really see what we have up in here, but we're going to be in a Coastal Living, and we're in Spin Sheet and Soundings, as well as you'll start seeing ads in the U.S. Airways and the Southwest Airlines magazines here starting in March. So it's a great project. The level of support has been unbelievable, and I think when it's all said and done, we'll be able to look back on this with a great deal of pride and look forward to the next one. So we're good. Thank you. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Kara, this is a minor thing. Last weekend, I had the pleasure of taking two visitors to Norfolk on a two-hour tour of our mermaids, and I had downloaded the mermaid map, and it's not accurate. And I'm just wondering, with this coming, if there's anything maybe Visit Norfolk and we can do to upgrade the mermaid site. These were people that came here for another event, but they wanted to see the mermaids, and I knew where most of them were. But
good idea.
Yeah, anything that we can do with the mermaids as well, bringing them to other parts of the city,
sure,
and have them.
Yeah.
Mr. Mermaid?
Mr. Mermaid.
Can I work with you on that?
Yeah.
That's a great point.
Yeah.
All those sorts of tools, like the Cannonball Trail and the Elizabeth River Trail, all those sorts of things are definitely.
They ended up spending $90 in the Nauticus gift shop on mermaid stuff.
Wow.
I mean, that's.
They're still hot.
I know. They bought a poster.
Karen, just, I mean, I don't know where you're going to bring the Navy, the Army in to help you do all this stuff. But, I can't remember a moment like this in the city's recent history, and I'm talking about, recently, 50 years that we've had. I don't know if we've ever had an event of this size. We've had a couple off-sale events that have been really big, and the last one was spectacular, but we've never had anything to look like this. This party is going to go on for, it really is a wonderful moment in time. The governor's going to be here, and maybe some other high-ranking officials will be here. Everybody's going to, the entire General Assembly is going to be down here. They've got money in this, and there's going to be a big parade of sale. I mean, a air show at the beach. There is. What is the big kickoff event? I mean, isn't the symphony playing something? And I don't mean at the Hague, but is there another?
No, on June 6th, that's the closing night of the Virginia Arts Festival,
right,
and we're using that as the kickoff night for off-sale. So we'll be with the Virginia Symphony. And Ron Fisher, and according to Rob, some
is that in the Chrysler, or is that outside?
Chrysler Hall. Yes.
Okay.
And all of our council members will be certainly included in all of these events. And the air show is really going to be fantastic. It's been a very, very long time since the Blue Angels or any air show flew over the oceanfront. We had tried to bring the Blue Angels to Norfolk for this, but we weren't able to find the right airspace over Norfolk. So our friends at Virginia Beach agreed to take the show, and they're underwriting it. It's not an inexpensive ticket to stand up an air show, but they're adding that into the Patriotic Festival. So it's really working out well.
Can we get you on the Today Show, Good Morning America, something where you can? Is there any way that we can, or bring them here during this?
We're working, Dave Iwins and Associates is the firm that we're working with, and we're working with all of the local affiliates here, ABC, BEC with
right.
ABC,
yes,
and they're all working their angles to get their national broadcast teams down here as well. So we're working that angle pretty extensively.
Good.
The thing that I don't have to tell you all, this is election year, and on our security team, there's every expectation that this event will be the must-come-to event if you're running for any sort of political office. So if we have presidential candidates here, which there's a good chance that we will, as well as all other levels, when you have this military background and you have a strong patriotic message, you bring those sorts of folks here, and you also get the national coverage on top of what we're doing here as well.
Something that sort of happened on the fringes, but is happening right in the middle of this, is the U.S. Navy support, which is a monster this year, which they've always been supportive, but they are driving this thing almost. So.
Admiral Harvey himself
heads up the, they call the advisory council, the National Advisory Council. He heads that up himself, attends all the meetings, and is 100% committed to this.
Is this the poster for the event?
This is the poster.
And how do we get that before it sells out?
I have one for all of our council members.
Cool.
You've just blown
my
surprise. But, you know, I've mentioned Gary Brandt. We really wanted something special for this event. We wanted a Virginia artist. We wanted John Barber, who's done beautiful, beautiful work. But he comes at a pretty steep price tag. But Gary Brandt knew that that's what we wanted to do, and he commissioned this. He sponsored the commissioning, and it's a beautiful piece. So
I look forward to my print.
Thanks, Karen.
Thank you.
You're doing a great job, Karen.
Just wait till the West gets something like says, no, you can't.
I was just going to say, wait till they hear the WHI's offer.
The West Kent Civic League says no parking.
There's going to be.
There's
going to be an environmental event coming up.
All right, we go from that to Chimney City.
Thomas says you can ground them up on East Beach.
That's right.
I'm sorry about that.
Just pull their halls up.
We got boxes with two really fire things, and two things that people really enjoy.
Opsale and Chick-fil-A. I'm here to tell you a little bit about an offer we've had from Chick-fil-A. And don't have to clicker. Basically, what we're talking about is the former Burchard Dairy site, which is located right here at 18th and Monticello. As a point of reference, you've got the row at Ghent, Alexander at Ghent. This is Ghent Elementary School. This is the HRT building as it currently exists, and this is a somewhat dated photograph. This is where the new construction for the HRT building is going up. Chick-fil-A is proposing a corporate store, freestanding, between 16th, 17th, and Armistead. It's the location of the former Burchard Dairy. Our offer from Chick-fil-A is at $800,000. In addition to the construction jobs, we're estimating about 75 jobs created as a result of the Chick-fil-A being located on this site. It is zoned I-1, which accommodates the proposed use with the special exception required for the drive-thru. The project adds only the second standalone Chick-fil-A in the city. The other one is up Chaniff. Right now, the current assessed value on the property is $1,666,800. We estimate that when the construction is complete, we will be at that real estate assessment of $1,357. Annual sales, $2.8 million. And projected city revenue off of that, $263,000. Annually, 10-year projection in excess of $3 million. So what we're recommending here tonight is that we look at entertaining and go into a contract with Chick-fil-A. We would develop a letter of intent with our legal department and draft a land disposition and development contract. Obviously then would follow with the public hearing and then authorization by the City Council for the consideration of that ordinance authorizing sale of the property. Can I answer any questions regarding?
Yum.
What's
Yum.
Yum.
Yep. Yeah, so I think it's a good project for us.
Thank you.
Thanks, Chief. It is, you know, it's between the gap and downtown and
they would do all sorts of shopping centers, too.
So, good evening. This is picking back up, as the manager mentioned, on desire of council to look at BPOL, and in particular authority that was granted by the 2011 General Assembly. So direction that you gave to the administration last fall. As staff looked at that particular authority that was granted by the General Assembly, it was understanding that we needed to look not only at just the BPOL tax, but also the business experience in Norfolk. And that's what we just want to get a touch on, as you've seen with the Lori's presentation and with Chuck's, we do have a focus on how is it that businesses look at Norfolk and what is it that we can do in our operations to attract, retain businesses and grow businesses here. So while the the exemption program in BPOL might be seen as a remedy for a solution, we really want to look at across the board, and that's what the administration will be doing over the next couple months comprehensively, not just from our Department of Development, but also all departments, and looking at customer service that we have from those departments. Specifically, we're looking at BPOL tax, we're looking at business recruitment and retention, permitting, and our processes for permitting, and then other taxes and fees. These recommendations are going to come to you in the form of presentation and also some background information at the next Finance Committee and also budget work sessions that we're going to have throughout the month of March. Specifically addressing what your request was, and that was for the administration to bring to you a response about the exemption program that was authorized by the 2011 General Assembly. As we looked at that, while that is one approach to providing an opportunity to invite business growth in the city, we realized that it essentially creates an inequality with existing businesses. And when we looked at some other best practices, particularly within the Richmond area and Northern Virginia, there are other methods that are being used to provide relief to businesses that does provide more quality and not just the exemption program. To date, Virginia Beach and Chesapeake are the only two localities in Virginia specifically to enact an ordinance that provides an exemption program for new businesses. But they were also the two localities that requested that specific authority from the state. So we, as we continue to develop the budget, we're looking at different approaches. And what we have that we've provided to you in your handout is an overview of the tax and how it's administered. Again, this is the business, professional, and occupational license tax. A regional comparison of our rates in Hampton Roads, what the state allows for the exemption that was program that was provided during the 2011 General Assembly, and then other options that are being used. As I mentioned, there are localities in the Richmond, Northern Virginia area that are taking a different approach, and that's some of what is attractive to us for how to provide some relief on the BPOL tax. So we're going to leave it at that for now. I'll take any questions and get into that, but what we're basically doing is teeing this up, and we've provided you with a pretty extensive presentation that walks through some of the basics and an overview and a description highlighting those other localities' programs.
And we hope that this is a process that we'll continue to go with different issues. For example, Councilman Riddick, last time we met, talked about senior disabled tax relief. So as opposed to just doing these one at a time, we want to look at a comprehensive package. We had a lot of discussion in the fall about how can we be friendlier to businesses. So it's not just do you take a two-year exemption for new businesses and coming to Norfolk. How do we look at that permitting process? How is the starting point in Norfolk different from a starting point in Virginia Beach? We would like to use the different committees as the sounding board, and what you have in front of you and what you received, I believe, on Monday was some information on real estate tax, and today you received some information on BPOL tax. And together, we'll work it through the committee structure. Okay.
This may look familiar to you because this is actually very similar to the presentation you saw at your joint meeting with the Planning Commission, where we talked about ordinance revisions regulating two things that are very different under city code but look very much the same to people, and those are electronic changeable copy signs and public service message boards. We presented this information to you in July. You gave us the direction to move forward with a complete ban on the electronic changeable copy signs, which are those that are dealing with, for example, some special sale, a time and temperature issue, as opposed to public service message boards, which are those that are providing information to tourists about what the public would be of interest in, things like the Jumbotron on the side of Nauticus. The ordinance that we have is reflecting the work we did, and it does reflect the fact that since we have been dealing with these two issues, the Planning Commission has denied every single electronic, recommended denial of every single electronic changeable copy sign that's come forward, and they've also recommended denial of the public service message boards. You've routinely approved the public service message boards, and you've approved about 5% of the electronic changeable copy signs. They're very similar in that both of these do provide for variations in illumination, message, color, and patterns. The electronic piece can't be more than 50% of the area, and the message has to change. Right now, they are permitted by special exception in every area in the city that is shown in purple here, and the option we gave you last July was either to refine the locations and permit them by right in those locations or prohibit them. And so what we looked at doing was saying, let's only allow them in commercial zones and light industrial districts and prohibit them in our localized area sign overlays where we have special regulations governing these uses, prohibit them in our pedestrian commercial overlays because these are not a pedestrian-oriented sign, and prohibit them in our aesthetic grant areas. And with that, those prohibitions and those limitations, you're down to the area shown in green. Well, then we also said this could be an issue for residential areas, so we propose to prohibit them within 300 feet of any residential frontage, and where you end up with at this point is they'd be permitted on Hampton Boulevard, East Virginia Beach Boulevard, Terminal Boulevard, Monticello Avenue, and East Little Creek. That seemed very narrow, and so our recommendation was to prohibit the electronic changeable copy signs. We have met with people from the sign industry, and they understand this. I'm not going to say they love it, but they have indicated they can live with this.
What about the signs on billboards that change?
They are currently prohibited in the city. The public service message board is slightly different. It's exactly the same issue with regard to they provide for intermittent variation in illumination, message, color, and pattern. But they're providing information about services to the public or to tourists, public events, tourist destinations. So these would be things like a sign outside of scope, the Jumbotron. I said at scope, the Jumbotron is at Nauticus. Those would be allowed with this. We also have a public service message board at the Attics, for example. What they're currently doing is permitted in specified downtown areas. For example, the Jumbotron is not one of the areas where they would be allowed, where they're currently allowed, but the sign at Scope is expressly permitted, as is the one at the Attics Theater. Well, the problem we've got is as we grow and as we become more interesting and we mature as a city, we recognize that there's going to be a growing interest in doing this technology at places like light rail stations, TODs. We talked about doing some of these type of signs at a bus transfer facility if we were going to do one, and our current regulations don't allow them. So what we had recommended to do and what you have in the ordinance is the prohibition on the electronic changeable copy signs, but we expand the area for the public service message board to include any city-owned or city-controlled property, and this includes property that would be owner-controlled by an entity of the state to allow them, for example, ODU. And also to allow them in TOD so that we have the opportunity to provide them around our transit stations. What this would have the effect of doing would be of allowing more of these kind of public service message boards downtown, which would add to some of the vibrancy downtown. Would allow us, for example, to do something like this on one of the Overstreet pedestrian bridges if you wanted to.
And the transfer station, the bus transfer station.
Bus transfer station, this would specifically allow. The administration recommendation is to approval, and what we looked at was the areas where they would be allowed, where the electronic changeable copy signs would be allowed if we did all the restrictions. There just aren't many, so it doesn't make a real great deal of sense to continue to go through this exercise with the Planning Commission saying no every time one comes in. But we do think that we need to improve the way we're communicating with our visitors, so for that reason we would be supportive. Planning Commission, after reviewing this and seeing the same information and presentation you're seeing, also recommended approval by a 5-0 vote. This evening, you're going to be asked to set the public hearing so that we could move forward, but because it has been close to 8 months since you saw this before, we wanted to make sure that you were remembering what is in this proposed ordinance.
Okay, wow. But we now have time for council interests and concerns. Mayor, before we go to that, if I could just raise two issues. One is that you have, I believe before you, the plot. We have an ordinance for the plot. We did not make it. It did not make it into your package on Friday. We sent out a message yesterday basically saying we just couldn't get it together. There are really no issues there. What's happening is this is allowing phase one of the plot to occur. And that is the ordinance that's before you. It would be in addition to what was in your package on Friday. And if there are no concerns with that, the only other issue I'd like to bring up is that waterside. Last month, we had a discussion about the 5 proposals related to waterside. And what I would like to say is that at that time, the RFP basically was put out, and we asked the free world, what are your thoughts about waterside? What would you do in order to link the waterfront, keep it vibrant, have some of the aspects of the waterside that we have come to enjoy over the course of the last almost 30 years. Since that time, we have had an opportunity to discuss each one of the proposals. In other words, we have the committee that was put together, about 7 individuals, and each one of the proposers had an opportunity to present either in person or through other mechanisms. And I will tell you that right now we're at a point where we have come to a conclusion that we believe that we have the top 2 candidates for you. While I said to you a month ago that we would do a recommendation by the end of the first quarter, we are still prepared to do that. But as we went through the process, the presentations were so good, we thought that it would be very difficult for us to filter that information and provide it to council. So what I'm recommending to you tonight is that I have contacted the top 2, which would be the Hardy-Lindsay Public Places proposal, as well as the Cordish proposal, which I call it the entertainment proposal, and ask would they be okay with coming next week. We have a work session next week that's already planned. We would have the Rex and Parks Commission here, and then we didn't have anything after that. But we would have them come, and they are agreeable to this, to do the same presentation to the council and the same presentation to the public that we received earlier this month. Again, they were dynamic presentations, and I think that this provides a great opportunity to get input both from the council and the general public. And I must also add that both of the proposers suggested that they are very amenable to altering the proposals. So I think it's important that if that's something that they've offered to the group, that we'd like to make sure that we're getting input from the community prior to coming back to you at the end of March with a recommendation. I will add one more thing, that we do have 2 separate evaluations that are going on. So in other words, we're not prepared to make a recommendation to you about a final selection or any selection at all, because we are waiting for 2 evaluations to come back. One evaluation deals with the Hotel Conference Center. We had a study done back in 2006. We basically asked that study be updated to take into account what's happening in the city in 2012. Also, we have a group that's doing an analysis of what would be the impact of something like the Cordish proposal on the city, given that things have changed over the years. In other words, what would be the impact not just on Grammy Street or the mall, but also other venues and even to the point of 21st Street in Collie. It's very important, I think it's important to mention that the Huntley Group is doing that evaluation, and Dana Nottingham, who is very familiar with board design, is a part of that evaluation. So again, we still need time in order to meet the March 31st deadline with having a recommendation to you. But we think we're at a very good place where we have what we consider the top two candidates, and they are more than willing to come next Tuesday and make a presentation to the public.
I got a question. In that study that they're doing, you're saying they're looking at Granby Street, 21st Street, and the MacArthur Mall. I understand that, but you know that I would hope that they would be looking at the region as a whole. You know, because we're not in competition with ourselves. We're not in competition with Granby Street, 21st Street, and MacArthur Mall. So to me, I mean, it would do a disservice to the citizens of this city, for whatever sector they may live in, for us not to move forward with a project because we think that is going to hurt a few of our thoroughfares, and ultimately other cities are building up. So if other cities have it, then these same people that you think that are not going to come to this particular area are going to go elsewhere. And so I truly believe that we got to continue to push the envelope. And I think that the more we have to offer downtown, the more people are going to come downtown, and they're going to find other things to do in and around downtown. And so I just think that we got to get creative in terms of defining the districts, no different than Richmond or any other city. Whether you have the Shaco Bottom or Carytown, they've branded those areas. You know, we've talked about this from time to time. What are we doing to make Granby Street attractive other than calling it Granby Street? We talked about putting lights from one end of Granby Street to the other end of Granby Street to really start to define these districts. Or on 21st Street, branding that with flags and banners so people know where they are. So instead of just saying, you know, we're not going to compete with ourselves, and we haven't even scratched the surface in terms of understanding what the capacity could be.
I agree with you.
You know, and so I'm just, you know, I hear that quite often, that if we do this, this is going to hurt this. You know, so then we do nothing, and then we slowly lose our momentum, and then folk go elsewhere. So that's what's happening.
Oh, that's an excellent point. We'll make sure that it's broader than just the city, yes.
I agree. Okay, then we are agreed that we will have, I think the idea of having the presentation made to the public is a great idea. I think, you know, it comes right back to this notion about greater transparency, which I've championed my whole time here, as you know. I'm learning, even an old guy like me is learning. So I think it's great, and the public will see it at the same time the council sees it. And
I would offer that what we'd like to do is have it somewhere on the waterfront. In other words, maybe even at Waterside or at the Nauticus Theater, but still having that backdrop so that we're actually out of this building.
Waterside would be great, just
the
building itself.
Oh, there's nothing.
Terry
mentioned it.
Terry.
I said there's...
Well, on the other hand.
Forgot about it.
So in the last presentation that we got, we stopped short of talking numbers. So in this presentation, will they cover the number? Will we get an opportunity? Will the numbers be unveiled in this conversation that we will have? You know, you talked about that they are flexible in terms of changing. How much change? Is it changed to the point that we're talking about a whole new project? I don't want to leave there knowing no more than I knew when I walked in there. And that because of what we're saying, it's a whole new project. So the RFP really didn't mean absolutely nothing, because by the time we get through talking, we could do this, they start saying we could do this, we could do that, whatever you want. And so I would hope that, you know, when we do have this conversation, that based on the proposals that were presented, that we at least get into the nuts and bolts so we understand the numbers. We understand what is being asked of the city. What is the developer willing to put in? What type of skin does he or she propose to put in the game? And that type of discussion. So I would hope that we would frame that and not just come into, you know, this conversation and this whatever you guys want.
Sure. We have, well, to answer your question directly, we will definitely have prepared a side-by-side in terms of what was in the proposal and what would be, you know, the skin in the game from the private sector versus what would be asked of the city. I think what's important, Mr. Vice Mayor, is that what we learned from those presentations are that there are some aspects of it that you couldn't pick up just flipping through pages. So the main objective for us is to make sure that the offerors are given the opportunity to provide you with all, every aspect of the presentation, the proposal. But it is important to note that they are flexible to basically say if this is, you know, some element that you would like, if you would like something that is an attraction specifically to Norfolk or something that's Norfolk grown, that could be an element of either of the proposals. So that's what I mean by the flexibility is not just take it or leave it. They want to, you know, get some input because some of the questions that you brought tonight may be something that they would be willing to address.
What are we talking about? I mean, because the RFP went out specifically for one site. One proposal deals with a couple of different sites, and one deal with one site. So what are we talking about, you know, within that? Are we going to address the RFP site, or are we going to address multiple sites? Because that's not what the RFP went out for. Well, and one of these proposals speak to multiple sites, and one of them speak to one site.
Well, the RFP, what we wanted from the RFP is someone to address the entire waterfront. How can you tie it in? So when we looked at the RFP, we started with the Wisconsin all the way down to Harbor Park. So we really said to them, tell us what you will provide. Now is the opportunity, the way we look at it, for the city to say, thank you, this is what you said you would provide, but this is what we want.
If I could just make one more comment, and this is not in conflict with anything Anthony had said, is this notion that this piece of property is very special to our people who live in this city, and we have to treat it as not just an economic engine, you know, and it is, you know, we have a lot of folks who, you know, families that visit there on a weekly basis, on a weekend, and this has been very much a part of the public realm, and we have to keep, regardless of what kind of neat proposals we get, we have to keep in mind that we have a community here that still wants to be a part of any that I think wants to still feel free to come to Waterside, do what they do on a daily basis, during the day with their families and their kids, as well as have something very special that occurs in the evening. So I think it is somewhat of a balancing act because this is a very special place. So. Okay. All right. Thank you. Andy?
I don't have any council concerns, but just since we had Karen here today I'm very looking forward to June 1st to the 12th. What are we going to do? Do you have any plans for Waterside during that time period? I don't mean to put you on the spot, but you know, can we just turn it over to Karen and let her do what she wants with it? Frankly, I mean, if you have ideas, let her take it and work with it during that 12 days. She's done miracles.
So she don't want water.
She's done everything else.
She gave it back.
We have been talking with the administration. We have been talking with the private sector about what can we do in those 12 days, because the last we want to do is have everything going on around the Waterside and Waterside.
And the wind's blowing through.
That's right.
But the bathrooms are being used, I'm sure.
So we have a couple of proposals that we're working on that we can bring back to you.
Okay.
And Kern's a part of it.
I hope so. I don't have to. That was all.
I would imagine last week we read it with interest about Harbor's Edge, and while we don't have anything to do with it, I think, if memory serves me correctly, Norfolk set a precedence when Harbor's Edge was developed. I think we gave somewhere between $5 and $12 million towards the project. And so I would just hope that those of you who have some type of influence in the individuals over there, just kind of talk to them about sensitivity. And you can imagine, you know, a family being together 50 years, and all of a sudden, if one of them is a little bit more further advanced in terms of needing skilled care, they can't eat in the dining room with their partner, you know, for 50-some years. So, like I say, we don't have anything to do with it, but maybe those of you who are close to the individuals over there that make decisions. I'm sure we all are saddened by the shooting in Ohio, the school shooting. At last count, the third child, you know, has died.
The third
child has died. And that just brings me to a couple of things. Number one, you know, mental health funding mental health is woefully underfunded. And with the Community Services Board, I don't know how far it, you know, stretches as far as adolescence is concerned. But somehow, you know, if somebody has high blood pressure or diabetes, those type of things you can recognize, but mental health is something that's not easily recognizable. And we have all of our school students, school children going to school every day. And so somehow, you know, we have to find a mechanism to recognize, you know, what could be going on, you know, with a juvenile. And there's just so many things can be going on with children, you know, today. And then, you know, I think about our General Assembly who now up there saying if you have a permit to carry a gun, you can take your gun to work and put it in the drawer next to you. You can buy a gun a month. And I just wonder if it were the will of this body, how would we go about maybe eliminating the gun shows we have at school?
We had an ordinance years ago that prohibited the use of the scope for gun shows. And
were we challenged on that?
Yes. Oh my God. Yes. And then the General Assembly took away our ability to.
So we have no right.
It's not going to work.
No, but I mean, we really this city was one of the few cities in the Commonwealth which actually instructed its administration not to rent public buildings for the purpose of. I mean, there was all sorts of good public policy reasons not to do that, for the sale of handguns and guns. And then the General Assembly passed a statute saying that we had to do it.
Well, I guess the only point I want to make is that whether it's on the school administrative side or our side or the police department or health department, we need to do whatever we can do to make our children as safe as possible in school.
And we used to, before budget cuts, they used to do a full suicide analysis of every freshman in the building. They would have them take it in their PE classes, and that was eliminated as part of budget cuts of the program. But you would be surprised how many students they had identified in that process and were able to refer them for counseling and other services. But that has been completely eliminated. They do not do that anymore.
Do they have any counselors in the school if children are, you know, I mean, with everything that's going on in economics and the economy, and kids are dealing with things that they've never really had to deal with before, is there anybody in the school?
There's guidance counselors in the school, but they're
not necessarily psychological counselors.
No, right,
counselors.
We have a school psychologist, but even that's been cut now, that there's not a school psychologist in every building. They're shared. Mm-hmm. Like ours at Granby is shared with the elementary school. So it's just part of the unfortunate process of budget cuts.
That's all I had. Thank you.
But just a couple quick things. I'd like to get an update on where we are on the 161 Granby Street building. We talk about it and then we forget about it. And I was down there today and it looks the same. I don't know why the owner, and I know it's maybe under contract and be sold, why he can't shore it up so that we don't have to keep having scaffolding.
Trust building.
Marcus, that's a good. Do you think by next week somebody can at least give us an update on the union mission?
We've
I understand the HUD loan was supposed to have been approved by the end of February. Right. And if that's the case, there's probably 60 days to go to closing. Those guys are losing money every day, this U.S. development, but because, you know, they're paying the union mission guys for the. I think they're paying them a fee for not closing. But in any event, that and the building, the 161, so we could find out the status. There was another financing mechanism. It wasn't coming through HUD. It was coming through, I don't know, who was Chuck, who was the other?
VHDA.
VHDA, not HUD. That's VHDA. On that, on the old bank building. But every time you talk to them, they say it's like a week away or 2 weeks away.
Why don't we get up?
Yeah, that was kind of,
you know,
we had a brief discussion on it this morning, Stan. But if you could give me another week, so that we can get you something.
Just keep pushing back, and I want it to be successful, and I want them to sell, and I want them to restore it. But also wanted, I just don't know why they can't make it safe and reasonably less unattractive until they get to that point. I mean, I think if it had been any other code violations everywhere. Anyway, other thing is, I don't know whether, you know, I heard on television last night about this train horn situation and eliminating, trying to do whatever we, and I know in Ghent it's a big issue, and I know in St. Julian's and certain other neighborhoods it's an issue when they come home, come through, and I'm all in favor of working on that, but are we hiring a consultant? At least they represented that, okay, because I don't know what consultant would tell us that we don't already know that it's been okay. At least that's what they reported, and I'm thinking, why would we hire a consultant to tell us the trains are loud when they come through an intersection? I mean, it's something we need to look at and try to work.
Stanley was telling us about
We've actually, our Public Works Transportation Division has looked into the matter, and this is a recent issue that has come up. The Federal Transit Administration for railroads was now a few years ago put in a requirement that they have to do their horns. And now, as a pushback, they've made an amendment that allows you to establish some quiet zones. So we're in the process of gathering the information of what are the three or four different ways you can take each intersection and possibly create it into a quiet zone. We don't, I believe, have to hire an outside consultant to tell us that.
We can do that in-house.
Right. We're just going to, you're putting it together so we can get
it. It was at least represented or misrepresented, I think.
I gave him information that we got an estimate, but that we had not hired.
I'm glad.
There was a couple of different plans and terms that we could look at in that area, because the actual trains were right up against close to the home, very close, less than, you know, from here to that wall to the homes.
I understand the need. I'm right. All in favor.
But there were other alternatives, you know, along with creating a quiet zone. And so, you know, there's about three options that we were looking at, and that just happens to be one of them. You know, and so I think that the article was somewhat disingenuous, because, you know, we haven't even really settled in on either one.
Passenger rail comes in, and a lot of homes are impacted.
It was because the train left at, you know, whether it left at 5 o'clock, 4 o'clock in the morning, or it came in, and we were looking at if you back the trains, if you reverse it, you wouldn't have to worry about it.
I'm all in favor of improving the quality of life of the citizens and the retailers and all. I just think we have the capability in house to figure out that it's loud and how you can fix it.
I totally agree, but, you know, we want to make sure, like you said, the quality of life
for our residents. I'm all about it. I just don't think we need to. Misrepresented by the press last night. We hired somebody to spend.
Might not have just talked to the right people.
That doesn't ever happen either. Okay, that's all I have.
I would like an update on what's happened to the Tidewater Drive, the Francisco development, the one we all went to the fence on that and had a huge discussion on. And
Bonaventure,
yeah. And, you know, nothing's happening. It's still a mess. And what, in fact, the change that we voted for on the zoning, how that impacts the neighborhood. So I'd like an update on that. I'd like an update, Chuck, on the car restoration. Gentleman on Hampton, we had such great plans he did on how that was going to be fixed up, and it started with gusto and has not continued. I understand he's a little frustrated, and I'd kind of like to know what's the holdup on that. And there's a
vote we have today on this building on, you know, north of Brambleton, what used to be the Ghent Design Center. It's going to be taken over by a medical, to be a medical office building. I've spoken with Frank about it, who's clarified that it was not a public hearing for the Planning Commission, so it was not advertised. This group was not mandated to speak to the neighborhood, but now the neighborhood is upset because they did not come to the neighborhood. It comes for vote. I understand it's time sensitive for these owners who have to vacate another spot, and I know we can't mandate that these groups, or at least we aren't mandating, but it's another example of just one of the ways we could have smoothed this out. You know, it didn't have to come to this. If somebody could have just called the neighborhood and said, it's going to come up at the Planning Commission, you know, we just could have a filter that would make sure that happens. It's just all about communication. And unfortunately, now this has come up and the neighborhood feels like they haven't been involved in the decision making. I'm not saying it's probably a very worthy project. They haven't even registered a complaint about the project. They just registered a complaint that they weren't informed.
And Dr. Lilly, I didn't know about the specifics of the issue that you just brought up with the neighborhood, but we have spent the administration much of the last couple of weeks trying to get a better process, because what's happening is that when it's time for the public input, many times it's when the Planning Commission is taking a vote. So instead of us getting to situations where at the last minute there are big changes, and I have a couple of projects that just come right to mind right now, we're trying to factor in a way that early on we get more public participation, because we do have an issue.
Because we kind of split that ward. Ward 3 is right across on Tidewater Drive. The land has been
purchased. We talked about Bonaventure.
Yeah, they have purchased the land. So Bonaventure does own the land. I think the only holdup is a deal with HUD, how they get their finances. So
sounded familiar.
Yeah, so they're still, they're still on, well, from my understanding, they're still on track.
I think they got a little distracted in Chesapeake.
Yeah,
West
I think they, yeah. That may expedite a little bit.
Because of the time sensitivity, you're okay to vote tonight on it?
Well, Frank tells me that that these gentlemen need to move in because they're vacated another spot. Am I right, Frank?
You're correct. We do send out a notice about everything going through the design review process, which is this would have been placed on an agenda. The issue is it did not get advertised as a public hearing or as part of the Planning Commission's public hearing agenda. So if people are only looking at the Planning Commission public hearing agenda, they're not going to see it, because this is not a public hearing item that requires public notice. My office does send letters out. Mr. Jones asked us to look at how we could expedite things. So every application that comes into us, we do send a letter to the Civic League advising them that it is coming in, giving them contact information for an applicant. We typically would not do it for a development certificate, downtown development certificate, send that notice out. But we do post everything that we have coming online, and we are now starting the process. So we're actually trying to post it with a copy of the application as soon as it comes in, to try to look at how we can increase public notice of activity.
So you're saying that you did send a letter out because it was a downtown?
No, we do. It does get posted and advertised on the non-public hearing portion of the Planning Commission agenda. So if all you look at is the public hearing portion, you wouldn't see it. And that's the challenge. We have two agendas, public hearing and non-public hearing for Planning Commission.
You know, if I might as well, I did speak with Jack Plumgren, and they did discuss it at the Ghent Business Association. I also called Henry Conti to advise him that this is a cardiology group that's purchased the building, 40 jobs, a couple million dollars.
So they did call Henry?
Yes, we did.
And see, that's interesting because I was not told that. So that makes a big difference.
Well, I do think that, Business Association definitely discussed it at their meeting. Henry, when I spoke about it with him again yesterday, he said he didn't know that it would be an issue, but he was certainly going to alert his Get Neighborhood League folks. And I imagine that obviously what stirred the But it is a cardiology practice. Renova, representative me there tonight. They do cardiology and also take care of diet, nutrition, and exercise needs for cardiac patients.
Okay. Just a couple issues. One, reading the paper today about the Community Service Board, and I understand your posture and not speaking, but I truly believe that any time the city is using taxpayer dollars in any type of partnership, whether money's coming from the state and money's deriving from the city, and they're using those dollars to lease any type of buildings, that any entity that falls in that category needs to, check with the administration before those dollars are going out there and spending money, the types of money that has been spent, and they're not even in the building. I just think that due diligence needs to be done, or the conversation just really needs to be had, because that just doesn't make sense. When actions that are being taken or have been taken, if they had done their due diligence and just dug a little deeper, they would have found that was probably not the best use of city/state funds. So, I know we're in the process of working through that one, but I would just say going forward, any entity that we have that type of relationship with and they're using our dollars, that contingent upon that, that we have some input into that process. I just think that cuts down on those types of issues.
Just to dovetail that a minute, do our city attorneys not get involved with lease signing them or not?
We do, yes.
Can we look into what we signed? I can't imagine signing a lease where you don't have time, you can start paying. I mean, it's outside of anything I've ever heard of. I would like to get a legal opinion as to what we did. So.
I can get you a copy of the lease. That what the Community Service Board did was enter into a lease that commenced on September the 1st.
Whether they were in the building or not.
Yes.
Forwarded build-out monies.
They didn't get any build-out monies from the landlord. So they thought it was their business judgment that given the stress of the building, that the per square foot rental was a good economic deal. I reviewed the lease myself. I sent it to the administration, sent it to development, I sent it to real estate, and the Community Service Board made the decision about when they wanted to take possession. It was their business judgment.
There wasn't a clause in there that pending bankruptcy or something of that sort that they could stop and wait?
Right. There's not any relief from the lease because of the bankruptcy.
And is that a typical tenet of most of the leases that we as a city recommend or approve?
Let's be careful, because we as a city don't do that. We're not doing this. Okay? But no, I mean, because we get upset with the newspaper when they start using very easy language, when we start using it around here.
So
Marcus is going to tell you about
I spoke with Reverend Bryant this morning, okay, and I made a pledge to him that tonight, if this came up, I wouldn't speak to something I don't know about. In other words, even he this morning had some concerns about where they are. So basically, sure, the lease was signed back in August, and the way that this process works, it doesn't come through the administration. It did not come through the administration, but that's what happened. So moving forward today, if there's an issue with the CSB having to find new space, I made a commitment a month ago If that's something that's going to happen, the administration is going to be there to assist them. So how we got to where we got to, I don't know. We talked a little bit this morning, but again, I thank you, Mayor. I think what's important right now is us to figure out how we got to this point, as opposed to.
Well, I didn't mean to take the lid off the can, but I just wanted.
You're exactly right, Anthony. Right. I mean, I appreciate you bringing it up because I really agree with that. Yes.
The other thing I had was, we've had a few fatalities around the city the last couple of weeks. Has not been good from a public safety standpoint. I know that, you know, when the police can't solve every, when you look at these types of murders, you know, some of them couldn't be prevented by the police, even if they called them, you know, when they get there after the fact. My question is, is there a common thread, you know, to what we're seeing? On Ballantyne, the two were, you know, very close. I was wondering, we had a problem there in Ballantyne some time ago with young people, and I won't classify it as gang activity, but I'm just hoping that as the weather breaks, that we are on top of these areas that we see a spike, you know, and since these senseless murders. I did hear some rumblings again that they were going to dismantle the gang squad, but I'm here to tell you that we do have a problem, and although it's not what it was some years ago, I'm still reminded and during the springtime and as we get closer to school letting out, these homegrown gangs do. This is about that time when they start to recruiting young people. And so I hope that we wouldn't abandon, the job and the folk that have been doing a good job in that department or area, however we frame that, that we would keep the pressure on and allow those guys to stay together and combat this issue. So I'm concerned about that. I know that I don't know what the academy, if we got one going there, whatever the case may be, but I do know that that's a concern out there. And I would hope that we stay on top of that. I mean, that's just I'm trying to find the right words to address it, but I would just hope that we stay on top of that because that is truly a concern.
And that's more than fair. As a matter of fact, over the course of the last week, I've been in constant communication with Chief Chamberlain. I guess Demby Park, the recent homicide there, is one of the best examples of literally what goes on behind the scenes. And maybe we don't do enough communicating with the council about what goes on behind the scenes, but anything from, I mean, literally going door to door. And I think Lori sent you an email over the weekend, going door to door, talking to the business community, and literally having more boots on the ground, whether undercover or just with police marked vehicles. But to answer your question, basically what we are doing is taking it very seriously. And there are some leads that we have in the most recent homicides that I'll leave it at that. But the community has been very responsive, very helpful with us trying to resolve these.
And the last thing I would say is that it's probably a good time for us to get an update of your organizational chart. Who's doing what? Because people have been, you know, some people have. I called Wayne one day. He's not in codes. I mean, so he still addressed the issues. But to better understand who's where, you know, and who's that person for, whether it be code, whether it be, ACMs, who's doing what. And from a development standpoint, I know that we're in transition there as well, but it would still be helpful to know who's the contact person in certain areas. I mean, one person can't do it all. I'll continue to say that one person can't be that point person for downtown and then the neighborhoods as a whole. being able to address all of the needs and wants from a commercial and retail standpoint. Sure. So it would be helpful to understand who's where so we can hold folk accountable. Okay. You know, for me.
You mean by department, even like development you'd like to
yeah.
know? Okay.
Yeah, I'd like to know who's responsible for this corridor. If it's Lafayette Boulevard, who's the person that we hold accountable for that?
I would just like to add to a couple things. I had Community Services Board on my mind as well in terms of when we have agencies that are a part of the city or linked to the city and they're getting commercial leases and space, that, in my opinion, shouldn't be done by like a department head or a whoever. It's something that should be negotiated from one real estate professional, whether it's commercial or not, to another. And that way you don't end up sending a minnow into a shark. You know, so that some of this might have been eliminated if there was someone in our real estate office who was in commercial real estate, because a commercial real estate contract is a whole nother bear from a residential real estate contract. And there are a lot of differences and things that someone who does that every day would pick up on that maybe a department head or a division head would just kind of peruse over and think, oh, well, that's standard, when maybe it is and maybe it isn't, or maybe it's a negotiable item.
I think the CSB one is more on a personal level. One group, the landlords, of course, knowing the real estate, mm-hmm. and I don't know, did CSB even have a representative?
The one group, the owner being the shark, the one group of the CSB being the minnows.
Did they even have a real estate yeah. rep, or did they just do it themselves?
They did not have an agent yeah. that the director, Maureen, was the principal negotiator.
And so that leaves that agency without
that's
representation.
Great idea.
Yeah, and the city also, you know, when it falls back on us.
We've always had a real estate agent who negotiated leases for us.
For city leases, yeah.
For city leases. This is not a city lease. I mean, yeah. So we've always been able to strike good deals. This is not a city lease.
And I understand, and I'm just saying if they're spending, it goes back to the point of if they're spending city money and they're entering into a lease, I just think that some professional needs to be a part of that transaction
I agree completely. Yeah. What we find ourselves in is we have this quasi-state,
agency,
local,
right.
independent group out there who are acting independently of us.
Yeah.
And the sooner we fix that, the better off we'll all be.
I agree. In terms of gangs, I would also suggest if there's any hint to that there's not a gang problem, to talk to the sheriff's office. They house the people that they pick up from the gangs off the street in the jail, and they have a gang unit there, and they can tell you how many different gangs they have represented in the jail. And so if there's a question as to, you know, the validity or the necessity for a gang unit, you know, the number of people that we pick up off our street that we have to house in certain areas and separate because of this and that and the other would also lend some credibility to the fact that we do have a gang problem and we do need to continue with our gang unit. The last thing that I have is I'd like for us to hear from audit. From John, where he is. I think I remember asking for an employee, if you were going to do an employee audit, just to make sure we didn't have another unpaid employee for however many years, just to make sure everybody's accounted for. But I'd like to hear from audit to see what they're doing and where they are and, you know, what's going on there. And that's it.
I don't really have much. Anything other than just a reminder about the ODEC, the coal plant. There's kind of a timeliness issue with that because they're going to ready to vote on that. And if this council is going to take a position on it, we need to do that. And I mean, we're not meeting again until a formal meeting.
When you say who's getting ready to vote?
Surrey.
Surrey.
Yeah, I mean, they're probably sitting in this room are more experts just from our citizens on what's going on. There was a meeting last night. In which some conversation, I mean, it went pretty late, but if we're going to take a position on this, we need to do it as soon as possible. If not, I mean, there's no point of us taking a position if it's going to pass other than to let our citizens know that we did care. by then it might be too late.
Yeah, I would agree too. I read Ann's answer today, but I still was a little confused about the delay.
I don't know. Every time an environmental issue is brought up, it seems like it's never addressed. It just gets dragged on and dragged on, or we don't want to take a position on it. But we need to understand that these projects have long-term effects on our community. I don't care if they're miles away. They do. And, you know, the Chesapeake Bay group, they've done a study on this. They know what the impact's going to be. And I don't understand why we're not taking a more proactive approach with that.
We can do it next week.
I think they're voting on it on Monday.
Yeah, it's too late because Surrey's voting.
That's
not the final. It's at a committee or commission.
I mean, haven't they even actually pulled the permit process? I mean, they're not even seeking. Last I heard, they weren't even seeking.
That's what you're reading.
No.
That would happen after they vote on it.
It's a study issue.
Okay. Well, I guess the first thing we do is kind of gather some information as well, too.
Well, isn't the information gathered?
It's done.
Yeah, so I mean, why can't we vote on it next week?
Why don't you share? How about you sharing the information with us?
Well, I just received the information, I guess it was yesterday.
Okay. So we can gather.
Is anybody in favor of it?
I don't think it puts us in a bad position on anything with
our regionalism. I'd like to know what the facts are.
Think asthma.
Foundation.
Think not breathing. That's it. There's one start.
All right, we're done.
Listening classes, Mr. Riddick?
Yes, sir.